Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good to see you. Well, it's good to see all y'all up there. The multitudes up there on Facebook and YouTube. Praise God. Glory to God. That was great. Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. You can go ahead, son, if you want to. Oh. You got a word?
Thank you, Jesus.
You got a word? Oh, okay. How about Dad?
Daddy always got a word.
Praise the Lord. Good morning. Welcome. I'm having to find something right here, sir. Yeah. Well, what do you share?
Four?
No, I'm not worried about your preacher. No, we're getting wrong. Go ahead.
Where's the mic?
Yeah, hook it up. I need to hook it up. We're very organized here.
Yeah, we are. Praise God. Hallelujah. I just want to share something that the Lord showed me this morning. I felt like it was for the body. So during worship, praise and worship, I seen a door. I think I told Richard about this.
Yeah.
But I seen a door. It was a big, beautiful, magnificent door. And as I walked up to the door, I could tell I was in a wonderful, beautiful place. But as I walked up to the door, I noticed the door had seven handles. It had three on this side, three on this side, and one in the middle. And at first I was like, well, Lord, which handle do you use? You know, how do you get in? Is it a trick door? Do you open, you know, is it, if you open this handle, the door with this handle, does it go here? Or if you open them? And the Lord spoke to me and said, those seven handles represent the seven spirits of God. And that's how you enter into, because once you went through the door, you entered into the courts of the king. And you could enter with thanksgiving. But that door was the seven spirits of God.
Amen.
And the Lord said, that's how you get into the courts, into the throne room, leading into the courts leading into the throne room.
Yeah.
It's by the Spirit. And the Lord encouraged me. The Lord encouraged me. He said, encourage people to exercise their right to open that door.
Amen.
Into the
courts.
Exercise your right. This is for everybody in Facebook, YouTube, anybody sitting in this room. Exercise your right, your opportunity, your right, your given right.
Come on.
By the King of the universe.
Yes.
To enter through that door, because you're covered. The threshold is the blood of Jesus.
Yeah,
that covers you.
Yeah, come on.
And that's how you enter in, by the blood of Jesus, through the Spirit, into the courtroom, into the throne room, into the presence of the King of the universe.
Thank you, Father.
Yahweh.
Yes.
Our Lord.
Yes.
He's also our Father.
Yes.
He's also our daddy.
Yes.
He's not just a father, he's a daddy.
Yes.
He's the one that loves us.
God, our Father.
He said, enter in, exercise your right, the opportunity that he's given you to enter into his presence.
Yes, Father.
Through that door.
Yes, Father.
And the things that he will show you and the things that you will see.
Yes,
you can't even imagine.
Yes, Father.
But it's there. Always has been. And the opportunity is yours, because it's given you. He has given you the right to enter in to the throne room.
Yes, Father.
Through the courts, through the Spirit.
Thank you, Father. Yay. Praise God. Yeah.
Lord.
That's the word of the Lord. Your faithfulness in this last year, especially, and we don't know what's going to come up this year. Well, we do know, but we don't know if we can share it or not. Praise God. It's going to be good, though. Praise God. That was good. Thank you for sharing that. Praise God. Did you trying to find your scripture?
Yeah.
Okay. Am I making you nervous?
No.
I'm trying to. I'll try.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see y'all here. Praise God. What God put on my heart today is about giving from my heart. Because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 9, it says, Lord loves a cheerful giver.
Amen.
And it's not supposed to be something that we do as compulsion or something that we have to do, but it's something that we want to do. And it's because we love the Lord and because we're grateful. And I think that's a big part of it, about being grateful for what he's done for us.
Yes.
And thanking him and loving him. And then we want to give to him because of what he's done for us. Hallelujah. And then it says he's going to, when we do that, he says we'll be enriched in everything, which causes thanksgiving to God. I'm not going to read all this, but I know that he said if we sow bountifully, we'll reap bountifully. So let's get ready to give our thanksgiving to God. Praise him, worship him for what he's done for us. Please. Such an awesome God.
Amen.
He's given us life and yes. health and peace yes. and joy. Everything yes. that we have. We don't have nothing we have, we don't have without God. All right, so let's do our confession. It says, we decree and declare,
we decree and declare,
we are sons of God,
we are sons of God,
and daughters of God,
and daughters of God.
We are made in God's image,
we are made in God's image,
and likeness.
And likeness.
We have the DNA of our Father God.
We have the DNA of our Father God.
As God is in heaven,
as God is in heaven,
and so are we,
so are we
on this earth.
On this earth.
We are the salt of the earth.
We are the salt of the earth.
We are the light of the world.
We are the light of the world.
We are the agents of transformation.
We are the agents of transformation.
Kingdom legislatures.
Kingdom legislatures.
Kingdom ambassadors.
Kingdom ambassadors.
We live.
We live.
And operate.
And operate.
In abundance.
In abundance.
Amen.
Amen.
We lend.
We lend.
And we do not borrow.
And we do not borrow.
Our God.
Our God.
Supplies all our needs.
Supplies all our needs.
According to his riches.
According to
his glory. In Christ Jesus.
In Christ Jesus.
And we can do all things.
And we can do all things.
Through Christ who strengthens us.
Through Christ who strengthens us.
We are more than conquerors.
We are more than conquerors.
We have divine health.
We have divine health.
We have divine life.
We have divine life.
We have inventive ideas.
We have inventive ideas.
We are blessed going out.
We are blessed going out.
And we are blessed coming in.
We are blessed coming in.
We are God's masterpiece.
We are God's masterpiece.
And we are loved.
We are loved.
Hallelujah. Glory. We love you. I love you, Yahweh. Come give.
One more thing. One more thing. No. Stay right there.
Stay right there.
We're still got our faith out. Amen.
Amen.
Right. This year is going to be a good year.
This year is going to be a good year.
So we're believing you for jobs and better jobs.
Jobs and better jobs.
Raises and bonuses.
Raises and bonuses.
Increased benefits.
Increased benefits.
Ideas for new adventures.
Ideas for new adventures.
Thank you, Lord, for bringing in ideas,
yes,
Father God, inventions,
yes,
creative ideas, business opportunities.
Business opportunities.
States and ceremonies.
Sold property.
Deals on purchases.
Deals on purchases.
Supernatural protection.
Supernatural protection.
For all that we steward over.
For all that we steward over.
Bills paid.
Bills paid.
Bills canceled.
Bills canceled.
Lower utilities.
Lower utilities.
Lower gas prices.
Lower gas prices.
Health and improved health.
Health and improved health.
Right there.
Health.
Health.
And improved health.
And improved health.
You need health?
Yes.
Right now. Health. Now. Health. Now.
Receive your health.
Receive healing right now.
Yes.
Receive health right now.
Health.
Right. If you're struggling with something, improved health right now. Improved health.
Improved health.
From this moment forward.
This moment forward.
My health is improving.
My health is improving.
It is moving forward.
It's moving forward.
It's moving forward towards the total healing.
Moving forward towards total healing.
Total health.
Total health.
Total health.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Daily blessing.
God reminded me this morning, because I know I've not probably been the best example of somebody following Christ or doing what you're supposed to do with your calling or your destiny. I know I haven't been the best example, but He reminded me this morning that everybody has one.
Yeah.
Everybody has a destiny. Everybody has a calling.
Amen.
And there are times when things do get in the way, and we allow things to get in the way. But He just reminded me this morning, He said, when you speak to it, and when you put my name and my power of my name behind it, the obstacle will move.
Yes.
It has to move. It has no choice.
Yes.
Because He is the beginning, and He is the end, and He is the author. It does not matter.
Yes.
When you speak something that God wants to happen, and you put your faith and His power together, there's nothing that's going to keep it from happening.
That's right. Come on.
Amen.
So when that obstacle gets in the way, you speak to it and say, in the name of God, move. And that mountain will move.
Jesus. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
That's right.
Praise God. Praise God. Well, good morning. Put up your Bibles or your electronic devices to 1 Peter. Does anybody actually have a physical Bible in here? You got one? You got one? Praise the Lord. Praise God. I tell you what, for Christmas, I bought off of eBay, I found me a translation that I had lost. It's called the Jerusalem Bible. It's a good Bible. I like it because in the Old Testament, they actually translate the word Lord as Yahweh. And if it's not Yod Heh Vav Heh, and it's Adonai, they'll tell you. Because there's a difference, but there's usually, and I've said this, shared this over and over again with people, especially in Hebrew, the old translation of the Old Testament, when you see the word Lord, it's not referred to, Jesus is our Lord. Jesus is Lord. But it's referred to Yahweh, the Father. Amen? So, kind of helps, it just keeps you in your remembrance of that. Praise God. Because God became flesh and dwelt among us.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God. So, turn to 1 Peter 5, and I'm going to share just a little bit. Y'all were very fortunate. I had something else that was going to take about an hour to share. I'll do that. Out of desperation, I reached for it. So.
Praise God.
There's such things as inappropriate praise God. No, it's always appropriate to praise the Lord.
Thank you for the fresh words.
Praise God. Praise God. The word's everlasting.
Amen.
Praise God. Let's pray for it. I know we prayed it, but we need to pray some more. Praise God. Father, we just thank you right now. We come before you in the name of your dear son, Jesus, Yeshua. We come before your very throne of grace, Father God, to obtain, find grace and mercy, Father God, in a time of need.
Yes.
Father, I thank you that your mercy, Father God, your compassion, Father God, radiate from your very throne, from where you sit in the heavenlies, Father God.
Yes.
And you extend your grace and your mercy towards every person on this planet, Father God.
Yes, Father.
You extend your salvation towards every person on this planet, Father God.
Yes, Father.
You extend your deliverance, Father God, to every person on this planet Earth, Father God. If Father, if they'd only believe, Father God, just only believe, Father God, the goodness and the mercy that you've stored up for them, Father God,
yes, Father.
And are prepared to release to them, they would rejoice, Father God, and bow their knee and bend their knee and thank you for your Son Jesus who provided it all.
Yes.
For it is through Jesus that it is provided. It is through Jesus that it has all been made possible. Thank you. And we thank you, Father. We honor you, Father God. We honor you, Father, Most High God. We honor you right now. We come into your presence right now, Father God. In our spirits right now, we enter into the presence of God.
Yes, Father.
By faith, Father, we enter in right now. We worship you. We worship you with all the hosts of heaven, Father God.
Yes.
We worship you, Father God, with all the angels of God, Father God. We worship you with all those, Father, that have gone before us, Father God, that are worshiping right now with us, Father God.
Yes, yes, Father.
The church of the firstborn, Father God.
Yes, Father.
The spirits have just been made perfect, Father God, in the heavenly Jerusalem, Father God, in the Mount Zion, Father God. We thank you right now to an innumerable host of angels, Father God. We thank you, we praise you, we glorify you right now, Father.
Yes.
We thank you, Father God, that there is a place prepared for us, that your Son said that. Jesus, you said that. Yeshua, you said that. There is, you go to prepare a place for us. So there is a place for us. We have our place. We have our space, Father. And we thank you for it right now. And we thank you, Father God, that by the Spirit of God, by the Holy Spirit, you've given us to live and to dwell on the inside of us. Yes. That through the Holy Spirit, the eyes of our understanding would be opened, Father God.
Yes, Father.
Cause us to be able to understand your word today, Father God. For surely your words, they are spirit and they are life, Lord.
Yes,
and if we receive them into our spirit and believe them, Father God, they're eventually going to find their way to our mouth, Father God.
Yes,
and as we confess what we believe in our hearts, Father God, it's going to come to pass in our lives, Father God. In our world, Father, that we have to live in, Father. So we thank you, Father God. We praise you. We give you glory. We give you honor right now. We pray for all those that are out there, Father God, that are listening, Father God, that you give them ears to hear, Father. Ears to hear, Father. Give us the tongue, Father God, to speak, Father, what you would say. By the Spirit of God, Father. By the Spirit of God, Father. We give you all the glory, for you alone are worthy of all that glory.
Lord.
Glory, Father God. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, Yeshua's name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Pardon me. Praise God. Wow. Well, this is the first Sunday of the new year. What's this, 2021? Did you ever think you'd ever live to be living the year 2021? Praise God. What was the movie? What was that movie we went to see with Kevin? 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Right.
Remember that?
Yeah.
Stanley Kubrick.
So far away.
Yeah, so far away. Yeah. Hey, we're back in the 70s. Yeah. We went to see it. Pamela went to see it. You know,
and
it was so far out. That was so far. To think we're living now. We're living in way past that. Way past that. Praise God. We are living in very exciting times, no doubt.
Amen.
So I don't need to remind you of last year. Praise God. And we're just looking forward to this year. We got the Lord's going to do this year. We expect Him to do good things. Praise God. So let's look at 1 Peter 5. I want to start at verse 6. If you bow, and this is the Passion Translation, so it's got something for you to read. So if you bow low in God's awesome presence, He will eventually, listen, He will eventually, say eventually.
Eventually.
Exalt you as you leave the timing in His hands.
Amen.
Let's look at the end. Let's look at the text at the end. If you bow low in God's awesome presence, mm-hmm. What translation must say? You be humble yourself.
Humble
under the mighty hand of God. Did that say that in one translation? That he might exalt you. So what does it mean? What does it mean to bow low in God's awesome presence? It means to bow. Anytime in the Bible it says to bow, of course the word baruch or blessed means to bow. But anytime you bow, you as an act of your will, you actually bow. You bow before. You always bow before someone who's greater than you. So here Peter says, he says, if you will bow low at God's awesome presence, because his presence is awesome. There are times when and the Lord spoke through Ivan, there are times of entering into the presence of God. Of entering into the presence of God. Now, we know that God's present. He's inside of us. Greater is he that's within us than he that's in the world. You're conscious, become conscious of the fact that God's dwelling on the inside of you. You are the temple. You are the very dwelling place. Your body, your physical body, is the very dwelling place of the living God. The Holy Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit is God. You understand? We understand that. I'm not talking down to you. I want you just to be clarified that you need to understand that God's living on the inside of you. The old theology that was drummed into people's heads and even spills over to people that are not even born again of sin consciousness of being. Now, if you're not born again, you are a sinner.
That's right.
But it spilled over into the church where people are so sin conscious, they look at themselves, they look at their mistakes more than they look at what God's done. Let me say that again. We look at our mistakes and our shortcomings more than what God has done. He is, let me remind you of this. He is a God. This is what Abraham believed. And Abraham is called the father of our faith. In other words, that's where the faith that the believer, the Christian, the born again, born from above, Christian should walk in. Cub stems from Abraham. And I've said this over and over again, you need to get it out of your heart. There's two things. There's two revelations that Abraham had. And he had them to the point where he was willing to, he believed it so much, he took action on it at the command of God. He believed one thing, he believed this, that God, and he did not know him as Yahweh. You understand that he did not know him as I am that I am. He didn't know him by that name. Only that was the revealed of Moses. Abraham knew him as El Shaddai. He knew him as El Elyon, the Most High God. You realize, if you go back and study the life of Abraham, realize he came from Ur of the Chaldees, or what's called Babylon now, the very heart of where witchcraft and the occult arts were spawned. Listen, and Abraham, what was different about Abraham was, even as a young man, Abraham began to see, God began to show him. Now, he didn't have a relationship like he came to have with him, or even a covenant with him. But surely God began to show him that all these idols that his fathers worshipped, his all his relatives worshipped, he knew that those things were not to be worshipped, that they were not the Most High God. Do you understand what a revelation it was? Come to this revelation. You live in a culture where people are worshiping idols. They're practicing the occult. Stuff's happening. I mean, this isn't just fairy tale stuff. But he realizes this, that there's only one God. There's only one God, the Most High God, El Elyon, the Most High God. And he began to, in fact, his one reason the Lord took him out of Babylon, of here, or the Chaldees, was to save his life. Because that would make you very unpopular. Are you following me? But this is what the revelation that Abraham began to understand. He said that God, this Most High God is the God that gives life to the dead. He gives life to the dead. And he calls things that do not exist or appear in the physical realm, he calls them into existence.
by the frequency and the vibration of his very voice and his word, Almighty God has the ability to speak things into existence, into physicality. Think about that. Now, go back to what I just said is about this mentality of well, we see our mistakes, we see our faults. And I'm not saying if the Holy Spirit, if your own human, recreated human spirit causes you to be aware of something that you need to have dealt with, I mean, I'm not saying deny that. Go ahead and receive 1 John 1:9, confess it, receive your forgiveness and allow God to continue to cleanse you from that iniquity or that lawlessness that's in your DNA. Don't hear me wrong. But this is what the consciousness of God. He wants you to be more conscious of the fact of the way he sees you. He put you in when you got born again, you were literally placed into the beloved Son of God. Don't separate ask God to help you, but don't separate yourself from the beloved Son of God, because you are in the beloved Son of God.
Amen.
When Jesus came to the River Jordan to be baptized, to fulfill all righteousness of what it was right, and his cousin John baptized him, the heavens opened, the voice spoke. This is my beloved. Say it. This is my beloved. He be loved. This is my beloved Son. In whom? Say in whom? In whom? In whom? Now you're an in whom. If you're born again, you're an in whom.
That's right.
You are a in whom.
Amen.
And you're in whom? Who are you in? You're in the beloved Son of God.
Yes.
So the Father sees you in the beloved Son of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
You mess up, he still sees you in the as you are. He sees you. He calls things that be not and don't look to appear as it. Come on, get this. As it were, if you don't get all this, you're going to go through life in a life of misery and shame. Identify with Jesus.
Amen.
Don't identify. If you go through the Bible, how many of you, when you go through the Bible, you go through the Gospels and you read stories. They're true accounts of what Jesus did in his earth walk. And you read and you tend to identify with different people. You identify with a woman with the issue of blood. Well, I'm the woman with the issue of blood. So I'm going to touch the hem of Jesus' garments. And I'm going to receive my healing. That's good. If that's where you face that right there, if you want to receive, God wants you healed. He wants you healed. You know, but you identified with that woman, right? But this is what the Lord wants you to do. Why not identify with Jesus?
Amen.
Why not be the one that has the virtue residing on the inside that others touch and receive their healing?
That's right. That's right.
Are you following me?
Oh, yeah.
This is what God wants to bring the body of Christ to maturity, where our identification is no longer the identification as a victim, but as a victor. Because he's made us more, what? More than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Say, he's made me more than a conqueror. This hyper-nikeo, which means hyper, you're a hyper-conqueror. Yeah, everybody's been around hyper-kids, haven't you? You know, it's like, you've been around hyper-people. He says he's made you hyper-conquerors, hyper-victorious. Now, how can he say that when he looks down here and sees us going around defeated and scared and fearful and worried about tomorrow, but he still calls us more than conquerors. You're more than conquerors because he's calling things that be not as though they were. He's speaking of them into existence. He's spoken that over you. He's spoken that over you. Your daddy has spoken that over you. Listen, you got born again. Listen. You were baptized. You were buried. The old man was buried with Christ.
That's right.
The old man of sin was buried with Christ, and he was raised to new, the new man, the new creation was raised unto righteousness, raised unto eternal life. When are you going to start believing that? We're not the old thing. That stuff's been broken. I know in my physical flesh I have the DNA that's been transformed. It will be transformed at the resurrection. But as far as my spirit man is, I am the beloved of God.
Yes.
And when my mind is renewed with the Word of God, and as you hear this, as you hear and you believe, it is actually causing something to happen in your soul to become into conformity to the Son of God. It's going to cause, don't be afraid to speak words of truth about yourself. Words of the Word, what the Word of God says, don't be afraid to say that. You say, God convicts you. God deals with you, but please, don't stay in that place. Don't stay in that place. Your daddy is up there speaking things over you, and yet you need to start seeing him as your daddy. He's your daddy. He's Abba. Jesus said, teach us to pray, our Father, Abba in heaven. Sanctify your name, or set aside, make holy your name that you've placed in your people, in your sons and in your daughters. He's up there speaking the Word over you. He's speaking the Word over you. This is my beloved son. This is my beloved daughter. This is my beloved. This is my beloved. This is my beloved. When the enemy comes against you, listen, she caught up my soul. When the enemy comes against you with sickness and disease, the Father said, no, get your hands off my beloved. This is my beloved. Yeah. This is my beloved. Yeah. This is my beloved. Yeah. When the enemy comes in like a flood, he raises up a standard of victory. Yeah. He's Yahweh, Nisi, the Lord God, our victory. The banner over us is his love. Yeah. He is the beloved. He is the beloved, and we are the beloved. We're in the beloved. Do you get it? You make your God up our side. This is a year. This is a year. You want to cut up on saying, this is the year, says the Lord. This is the year, says the Lord. When the revelation of the beloved shall be brought forth. This is the year, says the Lord, when the beloved shall come forth. Behold, I stand in the door and I knock at your heart and say this unto you. The beloved wants to come into you.
Yes.
And the beloved wants to ooze from the very pores of your body.
Yes.
And from the very pores of your body shall pour forth healing virtue.
Yes.
Not only healing virtue for the body, but healing virtue for the soul. Yes. And not only that, it shall come forth. Provision of abundance shall come forth out of your hands. Look at your hands. You see the script that's written in your hands, said the Lord. The destiny I have for you and have formed for you before you were ever formed has never changed. It has never changed. Whatever the enemy has sought to do to sidetrack you, I am greater than he is, and I have undertaken for you. Only believe me. Only believe me, says the Lord. For I love you and I have a great love for you, a great love for you which I have demonstrated in my son.
Yes, yes, yes.
Believe me.
Thank you, Father.
Yes.
Believe me.
Yes.
Well, I guess that's the word for the year. Good Lord.
Amen.
You always have to have a word for the year. Think about all the poor prophets last year that gave it. 2020 was a wonderful opportunity to give a prophetic declaration.
Amen.
And who'd known if it was going to turn out like it did. But it turned out exactly like the Lord said. 2020 was a year of vision. Mm-hmm. It's a year, you say, brother, I ain't seen an angel yet. Well, I bet you said a lot of other stuff you didn't know was hanging around.
Amen.
Huh? This is that 2020 was absolutely the beginning of the year of exposure of things that were hidden.
That's right.
That's true.
See, we all been positive type people. We think everything was going to be exposed was going to be pleasant. But it was the year the scab began to be ripped off so that healing could come.
Amen.
And don't despair, it ain't over yet. Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Shakara basa.
Yes,
Shakara basa. How do y'all believe the word of God? Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God. I'm just a Sunday school teacher. I didn't expect to do that. Praise God, the beloved Son of God. Accepted in the beloved. Praise God.
Amen.
All right. I even got the scripture of the Lord covers each of them. If you bow low with God's awesome presence, or humble yourself, just humble yourself. Quit being so dang full of pride. What he's saying is, quit trying to do it yourself.
Amen.
That is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, or as one translator said, the Hebrew translation says, it's the tree of function and dysfunction. That, what is that all about? What is the tree? You've heard that in the Garden of Eden, you know. The Father said, don't eat of that tree. In the day that you eat of it, you're going to die, or in dying, you shall die. What is he talking about? The tree it's the tree of good and evil. It's not just the tree of evil. It's the tree of good. It's what it is instead of Adam and Eve, especially Adam was responsible, just believe in what the Father said. If he just believed what the Father said, don't eat of the tree, you'll die. You realize that's just the deal. He wasn't trying to be mean, he wasn't trying to withhold, but the enemy created in his mind, or spoke to him, through, and he spoke to Eve first, and she eventually talked out of it. God, what is the first thing he created? What was the first weapon? It was doubt. Did God say that? Listen, if you go back to it, that is the book of the beginnings will tell you where everything starts.
Right.
It always starts with doubting what God has said.
That's right.
Yep. You follow me? You doubt. The Lord's spoken so many things through you and to you. And yet the circumstances, it surely has been circumstances in both of your lives. But it's caused you to doubt what God said about you. But the Lord said, listen, the Lord said, I'm not changing my mind.
That's
right. What I've spoken through you, I spoke through you, but I spoke to you. I spoke to you, and I've not changed my mind.
That's right.
Now, your response is up to you. The Lord wants us to love him freely.
Amen.
He don't want us to do anything out of grudging obligation. Even a giving is not to be done. Paul said that, out of grudging obligation.
That's right.
The Lord wants us to freely. That's why he gave us a free will. It's his desire for us to freely love him. With no strings attached. That's agape love. Agape love is love that there's no strings attached. There's no strings attached. We're used to the kind of love that's, somebody's always after something. Isn't it right? They got some kind of hidden agenda. They got something they want out of you. But God's love's not like that. There's no strings attached.
Amen.
He sends the rain, which is a sign of life, upon the just and the unjust. He's good to bad people. Now that's what growing up to be mature sons of God, that's where he wants us to be. To be good to bad people. We want to kill bad people.
Yeah.
Don't we? Or we would at least want to see something bad happen to them. Are you out there?
Amen.
But the Lord, this is the season you get to grow. God's gonna cause you. Now you don't have to. But there's a push. There's angels. There's push angels. The Lord showed me push angels one day. I used to think even though that's what made people fall down. You know, when you we'd pray for people, they'd fall down. And it is, they do push it down. But their push angels, listen, this is their push angels that put, they'll push you. Yeah, so you've got a free will, but that free will has got nothing to do with something it's courage you give. Give you a little push. So if you notice, you start being nudged. Now I got over to something that I know I'm not, I know who I am. All right. But there's angels out there that are out there to push. When I say push, I'm not saying knock you down. They're out there to, because you'll start listening. If you'll be sensitive.
Amen.
You listen to me. I'm not just talking about today. I'm talking about this. There are angels out there that are going to really get to nudge you in directions the Lord wants you to go. You ever heard the expression, they just need a little push? He's going to begin to nudge you. So listen to what I'm saying. I'm trying to remember it. Write it down. Be conscious of that nudging. I didn't say nagging. God don't nag. But he will nudge. Yeah, we do. We'll do that. He says, so bow low in God's awesome presence. Or just submit to bow low. He says, just give into it. Submit to it. Believe it. That's all you got to do is believe it. Isn't that easy? No, that's the hardest thing in the world to do is to believe.
Amen.
That's what they call it, the fight of faith.
Amen.
We say, well, that's not too easy, bro. We don't have to do anything. No, you don't have to do anything but to believe. The disciples came to Jesus and said, Jesus, she said, what must we do? What must we do? This is John. What must we do the works of God? You know what? Because you know, you understand that there was rigorous training in the school of the prophets. Rigorous training. They spent hours with their head between their knees, meditating on the name of God, just to try to get a God, give them a word, just a word. It's how easily words flow out of us. How easily prophetic words flow out. That it wasn't always that way. So they had training. They did rigorous discipline. They'd sit for hours and hours in total silence so they could try to hear the voice of God. These people, I'm telling you, this was boot camp, buddy. How easy it is for us.
That's right.
Or how easy God's made it available for us.
That's right.
So they asked Jesus, said, what must we do to do the works of God? They were ready for a 7-day seminar with your booklet included.
Yeah.
It writes to the stream. Only for $500. He said, what must we do the works of God? She caught up. Jesus said, believe. doesn't that make religious people mad?
Yes.
What is the 7 steps to happiness? Believe God loves you. I know all that, but what were you really? Come on, really. What are the, believe God loves you. Can't be that. But see how hard it is? You see how hard it is? You see how hard it is?
Sure.
It's hard. You want something hard, you got it. He gave it to you. Believe. It's the hardest thing in the world for a human being not to extend their hand towards that tree of the knowledge of good and evil and help themselves.
That's right.
You understand? Help yourself. I'll tell you this, God, the scripture that I was raised though, God helps those that help themselves, is not in the Bible.
That's right.
God gives grace. He gives grace and more grace to those that believe. Do you know that when you die and go to heaven, you're not going to have to go to work at a certain time and get off at a certain time working a job?
Hallelujah.
Huh?
Hallelujah.
He
did great.
He did great. But the Word of God says that you're seated with Christ in the heavenly place. Then what am I saying, brothers? You, I don't lay around the couch and watch Christian television and eat, and get fat and eat cookies or whatever. I ain't talking about that, because I got to throw that in there, you know. No, you can do, you'll have stuff to do in heaven. You'll have stuff to do, but it'll be the stuff that God created you to do, and you want to do it, you'll actually be happy doing it.
That's right.
So just walk you by faith. You got a crappy job right now. By faith, just enjoy it. This too shall pass. All right. Praise God. The Son. Okay. If you bow low. I'm what they call a prophetic teacher. A prophetic Sunday school teacher. If you bow low at God's right, He will eventually exalt you.
That's right.
That is an eventually. That's where patience comes in.
Yeah.
My God. That's what it's, I guess what translation must say patience, sir. You patiently. You wait patiently. That's what the deal is. It's by faith and patience you inherit. Amen. Faith and patience. Everybody sitting around waiting for grandpa to die so they get his house. You have to exercise some patience. He'll eventually die. It's coming to you. Come on. It's coming to you. But don't. What would we eat in the trail of knowledge of good and evil? It'd be trying to speed along. A little rat poison or something. Throw a little rat poison or something and speed things along. I can't wait. Isn't that what the prodigal son did? You know what he did? That's what he wanted. He wanted his inheritance now. Didn't he? He said, Dad, give it. You know how he heard his father to say, I want my, now listen, I'm going somewhere. If you listen, the prodigal son said, Daddy, I want my inheritance now. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? They hurt the father. The father said, it's all yours now. It's already is yours now.
Mm-hmm.
You just don't know it's yours now.
That's right.
You just don't know it's yours now. So what did he do? He reached out and ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. What did he do? And then where did he end up? In the pigsty.
Mm-hmm.
But the brother wasn't no better.
That's right.
He stayed home and worked hard. He's like the religious people.
Yeah.
They're working hard to get the kingdom. They're working hard to get the kingdom. And they get pissed off when the younger brother comes in and been drunk and cocaine and cracked out or whatever for so many years, lost everything, and then come back and then throws a party for him. That's what religious people think, see? Both of them will kill you. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, both of them will kill you. Good will kill you, religion will kill you, and the other will kill you, but the other will kill you quicker.
That's right. Come on.
You understand? You can go the route or just, you know, that's why I've seen this over and over to people. They either go, I'm going to be perfect, or I'm just to hell with it. I can't be perfect, so I'm just going to do what I want to do. Both of them will kill you. Which one of them will kill you quicker? But I tell you what, you can willpower it out for 40 years, but I tell you what, the law of sin and death sitting there waiting.
That's right.
Very patiently.
Amen.
And the only way you'll escape is through the grace of God.
Mm-hmm.
You need that hand to push you up, to bear you up. Some unseen hand that's carried you. Hey, you follow me. I don't want to get too much. Okay, all right. I know you get tired. He will exalt you eventually as you leave the timing in his hand. Say, leave the timing in his hand.
Leave the timing in his hand.
Pour out all your worries and your stress upon him and leave them there. Leave them there. Find you a place in your house. Get you a bucket. Go to Home Depot. Get you one of them $3 buckets. Put it somewhere in your house. Someplace preferably you can have access to it. Get you a notepad and a pen.
That's right.
And every time something comes to your mind that's bugging you, say, Lord, you do a little, just pray. You know, write it down. Fold it up, go to that bucket, throw it in there. And don't go back to the bucket.
Amen.
Unless you're going to take something else to throw in there. And it'll make you conscious of the fact is that you're going back constantly getting that paper out of there. and look at it. Are you following? Am I making any sense? Have I lost my mind?
Saying, does God need my help handling this?
Yeah. But you see, you practically, it's kind of faith without works is dead. I'm not saying you got to do that. We're going to be the church of the bucket church. We're going to all issue buckets at the front door. I'm not talking about that. I'm just giving you an idea to practically do that. He said, pour all your worries and your stress out on it. He can handle it. Some people can't handle it. You can't handle it. You pour all your stress out on me, man, you make me depressed. That's all right. I've got an anointing to do that. That's fine. But pour it out on the Lord. It says, pour them out, all your worries and stress upon him, and leave them there. For he, what? He tenderly cares for you. Yeah. Be well balanced. What's the thing? It says sober. Be well balanced. Always alert. Because, why? Why? Because your enemy, say my enemy. You do have an enemy. The devil roams around incessantly. Incessantly. That means he never ceases. Like a roaring lion. Like a roaring lion. You remember that if you see a cherub, he's called cherub. It says in the Bible they had the face of what? The face of a lion. The face of an eagle, the face of an ox, and the face of a man. Mm-hmm. Who is Satan? He's a fallen cherub. So he roars. So there's with manifestations of different kinds of cherub. There's manifestations: the roaring lion, the power, the eagle is the prophetic. The ox is that which persists. Patiently, consistently. Face of the man is the face of Jesus. The face of the image of God, the Son of God. Which makes the chariot throne that God rides on. She's pressing on somebody else's face. Anyway, he's what he comes around as a roar. A roaring lion. His credentials have been pulled. Yeah. All right, got it. His credentials have been pulled. Like looking for its prey to devour. Listen, what's it say? I'll finish you with this, because I'm going to talk. I want you to wake up. Listen, you worry about this COVID stuff. I don't know how many people stayed home today because not that they got COVID, but somebody they know's got COVID and they want to do the right thing and not come to church. That's fine. I understand you got a free will. That's fine. But I want to give you some advice about dealing with COVID. Anybody want it? Because I've dealt with it. All right. What's he say? He says, so let's just interject COVID into this. This ain't going to get me cut off. COVID roams around incessantly like a roaring lion seeking for its prey to devour. That can be physically, that can be economically, because it surely is hurting more economically far than physically. Because the recovery rate's 99.9 something. Don't say like, you understand? But having your business shut down and recovery rate sometimes is worse. Are you all right? You hear what I'm saying? See, it roars around like a roaring lion seeking for his prey. What does he say? Take a decisive stand against him.
That's right.
Right. All right, you want your points? Get your points. Right. First of all, take a decisive, do it now. Don't wait till you start having the symptoms of it. Take a decisive stand. Take a decisive stand. This stuff that's where according to where your face at, no, there's no contrast. Your budget is like it may be. I'm not getting this stuff in Jesus' name. Or maybe your face at, I get it, but I'm gonna recover. It ain't killing me. But make a decision. Don't make the decision, oh my God, this is a bad decision. Oh my God, if I get it, I'm going to die. Right. Oh my God. You are, you made, make a decision.
Yep.
Make a decision. It's what it says in the Word of God right here. Take a decisive stand. Quit being wishy-washy. Remember the Laodicean church? Jesus said, I wish you were hot or cold. I want to puke you out of my mouth. Make up your mind. You go for the trade from you ain't going you're not gonna wear a mask, you're not gonna wash your hands, and you're gonna stick your head up in somebody's face that you don't got it. Go from there, or go get you a hazmat suit and a shield, and stay in your house until 2025. Make up your mind what you're gonna do. What if I decide, Brother Richard, I'm not going to get it, I get it. At least you made up, did something God told you to do. Make a decision. Are you out there? This is no condemnation. This is the Bible. Take a decisive stand. That's about anything. Make a decisive that this is where I stand. Then the Word of God says, be prepared to give an answer for your faith. Didn't Paul say that? Didn't he say that? He said, be prepared to give an answer for your faith. Somebody asked you, why do you do what you do? Be prepared. Make a decision. I've decided to follow Jesus. That's my deal. Why aren't you doing this and why aren't you doing that? Because I've decided to follow Jesus. I'm going to go with Jesus. Whatever. Hey, what did Jesus do? Jesus said, I do everything. Listen, this question came up. It came up. Somebody brought this question about a certain sin that they were concerned this person was committing. They asked me, you believe they'll go to heaven? Well, first of all, I can't decide that. Jesus is what takes you to heaven. Amen. Faith in Jesus. But then they tried to get me around and say, well, is it wrong to do that? You know, I get this, the Lord gave this brilliant, brilliant scriptural thing. This is a good way to judge whether God wants you to do something or not. Jesus said, he said, I only do the things that I say my Father do.
Amen.
Do you understand that? He said, I only do the things I see my Father do. If I ain't seen my daddy do it, I ain't doing it.
That's right.
Now it's Jesus. We're following Jesus. If I ain't seen Jesus do it, I ain't doing it.
I ain't doing it.
But if I see Jesus do it, I'm doing it. Because as he is, so am I in this world.
Amen.
Amen. So he said, make a decision, take a decisive stand against him, and then resist his every attack. That means that gives you the implication that he's not going to give up on one shot at you. He's going to come on. You understand? He said, what does he do? He resists his every attack. With what? What are you resisting at? With strong, vigorous faith. Strong, vigorous faith. Strong, vigorous faith. Not milk toast faith. Strong, big. What is faith? Faith is believing in the heart and speaking it out of your mouth. You don't have to go out in the middle of Walmart and shout and scare everybody to death with your faith. Go in the bathroom. You feel, listen, I tell you, when the symptoms come, when the symptoms come, immediately do something about it.
That's right.
Don't wait, because this is the way things progress, the way the enemy does. Once he gets a foothold, he's got some ground to stand on. He's got a place to camp out, and he can work on it. If you'll stop him at the door, I'm just his advice to you. This is dealing with stuff like COVID. Stop him at the door and resist him with strong, vigorous faith. Do not. Now, I sound like old word of faith thing, but this stuff worked. So listen, because it worked for Jesus. I'll tell you right now. Say it out of your mouth. Say no. Tell it no. Talk to it. Say no, you're not coming on me.
No plague.
Call it what it is. It is a plague. Call it no COVID. Well, everybody's scared of COVID. Say, COVID, you're not coming on me.
That's right.
Say it out loud. I mean, don't die. Sometimes, say it out of your mouth. Why? Because is it a created thing? Let me ask you that question. No, I don't. I'm not getting into a debate about where it was created.
That's right.
You know, I know where it came from, but we're not going to talk about that. But it is a created thing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It's not God, is it?
Mm-hmm.
So if it's a created thing, it will respond. It will respond to the voice of God.
That's right.
Amen.
Y'all agree with that?
Amen.
Yeah. Now who's the voice of God?
We are.
You are. Speak to it. Don't respond to a disease like a sinner.
Amen.
Respond to the disease like a son.
Amen.
Amen. Do you get that? You can make up. I give you. You want to make some T-shirts? Make you some T-shirts up and say Ben Elohim. And then for you ladies, it's because y'all won't like this. In Hebrew, it would be Bat Elohim.
No.
Ben is son, Bat is daughter. But the fortunate thing for you is that he calls you ladies sons of God.
Amen.
So you don't have to wear a T-shirt that says Bat Elohim. And the people won't say, look at that old bat. How would you like one of them shirts? Son of God.
Amen.
Oh man, you want to make some people mad.
Oh yeah.
Get your T-shirt that says, "Oh no, I better not go there." Get your T-shirt that just says God on it. What do you say, brother? You say you're God? No. I'm not Yahweh. I'm not Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. I'm not the Father. I'm not the Most High God, El Elyon. I know who He is. He's my daddy.
Amen.
But I am His. See, you don't realize that people, Christians don't have any problem going around because saying this, they're children of God.
That's right.
Yeah, how many? That won't make anybody mad. You know what? As long as you're a child, you don't ever have any responsibilities.
That's right.
But when you become a son, a mature son, someone who's grown up, that walks in, that does what the Father does,
mm-hmm.
then you're a mature son, then you have responsibilities. Because this is what Daddy say to you. You down there on the planet right now. You're my son, right? Oh yes, I'm the son. I didn't say the only begotten son. Now you hear what I'm saying? I'm not a New Age teacher. I don't believe it. They believe that they're God, the God.
Yep.
I'm just saying I'm a son of God.
Amen.
And I'm not the son of God. I'm in the son of God. Oh, you got me? You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Coming. And then you say to the Father, you say, Father, what are you going to do about this? What are you going to do about this situation? Dad, you know what Dad's going to say? If you hear what he does, say, you down there, you do something about it.
Amen.
You take the trash out.
Amen.
You don't say that to somebody. You don't say that to a visitor. I've noticed this, you know. You don't have somebody come visit me. Hey, if you come over to my house, I'm not going to say, Henry, go take my trash out. I wouldn't do that to you. You wouldn't probably would take it out anyway. You probably would. Because you got a certain sorrow. I wouldn't do that. But I have no problem with one of my grandkids. One of my daughters, I wouldn't have any problem saying, go take the trash out. Why would I say that to him? Because that's my son.
Mm-hmm.
That's my daughter. I'm their daddy. I've been busting my butt for 30, 40 years to keep you alive. Take the trash out. Daddy says, go do this. Oh, I don't want to do that. You can't say, well, what have you ever done for me?
That's true.
I tell you what I did for you. I became flesh and came down there and let those people spit on me, laugh at me, mock me, beat me, and crucify me. That's what I did for you. You're under no obligation.
Sure.
Because I did it because I love you.
Amen.
But you ask, what did I ever do for you? I just told you.
Sure.
Selah. Sure. So you resist him steadfastly in faith. Do you realize how much the difference, if you walked around on this planet more conscious that you were more like God than you were like the devil, your whole life would be different. Wouldn't it? When you got a sin consciousness all the time, you're acting like your father. The devil. When you have a righteousness consciousness, you acted like your father, Yahweh.
Sure.
I'm just saying. Are you thinking? Is you burnt out yet? Man, who prays that prayer all the time? Your kingdom come, your will be done. You keep looking around waiting. Everybody standing. What did they do with Jesus when he left the planet? What did they do? They were all going. And the angels were standing there and they were praying. They could see him and they said, like King James, why gaze you into the sky?
Yeah.
My gaze. He was caught up in a cloud, which wasn't no cumulus cloud.
That's right.
He said the same way he left, the same way he's coming back. And you're going to be on the same, you're going to be standing in the same place you were when he left. I've gone too far. Praise the Lord. Let's stand up. Praise the Lord. Let's have this up to the Lord's table. Did you get anything out of that? Start acting like the Son of God. Now don't go around being stupid and telling anybody you're God. I didn't say that. Disclaimer. Y'all did hear me say that. I did not say that I was God. All right. You got it. And it's obvious you've been around me long enough. Perhaps people watching won't know that. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Ben Elohim. You're royalty.
Yes.
You are. Start acting like it. That does not mean, to it, humility, one of the hallmarks of a son of God is humility. See y'all at this one? Don't be strutting around. Thank you for listening, Lord. Rest of me, Isn't that right? Yeah, thank you. Praise the Lord. Thank you for joining. I hope you'll join us in the Lord's table if you've got some juice and cracker. We'll celebrate because this is our covenant. This is only what we've shared just now is only possible. Only possible because of Jesus. That he offered it, listen, on the night he was betrayed. The night he was betrayed. I heard someone say this. You know, he did say that on the night before he was crucified. That's horrible. That was horrible. But you know what hurts? I think worse than crucifixion is betrayal. Because you know who the only people that you love can betray you.
That's right.
Those Roman soldiers didn't betray Jesus. Those Pharisees and Sadducees didn't betray Jesus. They hated his guts. They killed him. But his disciples betrayed him. Mm-hmm. You wonder what love looks like? He's saying, I'm going to give my body, even though I know that you're going to betray me. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give my body. He said, this is my body given. I'm going to give it for you. He said, I want you to take this. He said, listen, I know. He did go out and say it, right? He knew it, though. Yes. What he did say at the table said, one of you is going to betray me. But they all betrayed him, except John. Mm-hmm. Every one of them. He said, this is my body, knowing full in his heart what was going on. And I'll give it for you. He said, I want you to take it now. Because I want you to be in me. I want you to bring. I want to bring you in the family. I want you to be in me. So when you take it, eat this. Just take it. Thank God for it. Just thank you for it. You don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. It's because of His great love. Shit, God, you're the splendor of God. Just right over there, the splendor of God. Just, shimmering. See, heaven knows this stuff.
Sure.
Heaven rejoices. The clouds of angels, the clouds of witnesses, they rejoice. It's holy, holy, holy. See, we see through a veil darkly. We can't really see it. If you can save, holy, 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 is the Lord God Almighty. Holy, holy, holy. Say it with me. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. 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 Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Thank you, Father.
Praise you. Praise you. Merciful Father. Kisha Karada, full compassion, slow to anger. Forgive sins. All you forgive our sins. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
All you merciful, kind merciful. To us, Lord.
Merciful.
Merciful to our transgressions, Father God, to our iniquities, Father.
Yes.
Bless you, Father. Bless you, Father. Praise you, Father. The only begotten Son of God. Crucified, dead, buried, rose again on the third day and ascended to the right hand of God the Father. He rose forevermore.
Thank you, Father.
After they'd eaten, he took the cup and said, this is the cup of the new covenant. This is my blood shed for the remission of sin. The remission of the sins of many. Those that will receive. We receive right now, Father God. We receive, Jesus, your blood shed for us to eradicate our sin and make us one with the Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, King Jesus. Thank you, Lord. To the King. Yeah, pray. Bless the name of the Lord. Kisha Talamasata. Ha ha. Praise you.
Thank you,
Father. Oh, we praise you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Now, Father, thank we thank you right now. That the blessing, you give us blessing, Lord. So we bless right now, Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach.
Yes.
The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord give you grace. And the Lord give you shalom, peace. Nothing missing, nothing broken. In the name of his Son, Yeshua, Jesus. Amen. Glory to God. Praise God. Thank you. Praise God. Thank you for joining us today.